And now we will learn how to use the Batch Enter Transaction window. Only the Accountant's Edition has the Batch Enter Transaction window. Here are some things you need to know about batch entering transactions. Number one, it's the most simple way to import transactions. Over 90% of the transactions that a company typically has will import this way, and you just copy and paste from Excel. So you need to know a little bit about Excel, but very little, because all you're really going to do is copy and paste. Now let's open the window and see how it works. Well, from the main menu in the Accountant's Edition, we click Accountant Batch Enter Transactions, and we get the Batch Enter Transactions window. Notice there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 different kinds of transactions that you can import. But these are the 8 most common and popular transactions that companies usually have. Notice when I choose a different transaction type, the columns become different. That's because different transactions have different fields of information. Now, first you have to choose a transaction type, for example, deposits. Then you have to decide which columns of information you're going to copy and paste from Excel. Now, not every transaction requires every field. So if we click this Customize Columns, by the way, we're clicking this Customize Columns at the moment the deposit type of transaction is chosen. So when we choose the transaction type, we get columns that QuickBooks suggests. But then when we click Customize Columns, we have choices to add additional information. If we want to add, a column for cleared, and that happens to be information that's in our Excel file that we're copying and pasting from, we can click on it and click Add, and it will add the cleared column. Then when I click OK, you'll see there's an additional column to tell us whether the deposit has cleared or not. If I want to remove it, I again click Customize Columns. I can click on the column I want to remove, and then I click Remove. Notice you can also change the order of the columns. If I click on Date, and I click Move Down, Move Down, Move Down, and then I click OK, notice Date has been moved over here. So this Customize Column button is the most important thing, because it not only gives you the ability to add or remove whatever fields of information you have when you copy and paste, but it also gives you the ability to change the order of the columns so that it matches the Excel spreadsheet that you're copying and pasting from. Please note, some columns cannot be removed. It depends on the transaction type, and each transaction type is different. For example, when it comes to checks, if you choose checks, and you click Customize Columns, you can see that the 3 columns that I have remaining here do not have the Remove choice available. I can click here to add a cleared column, add a billable column. I can pretty much add any column that's in the Write a Checks window. And when I click OK, and click OK here, click OK. Yeah, we also have to choose customer if we're going to make it billable, so we'll add customer. Okay, so now I have all these columns, and if I had an Excel spreadsheet that had all of this information, a piece of information for each check, for each of these columns, I could copy and paste from Excel. And of course, I could also change the order of these columns, move down, quantity move up, whatever I need, until the columns are arranged in the order in which I need them to be. But notice what happens. When I click Account, the Remove choice is not available. It's not available for Amount. For Cleared, I'm allowed to remove that. But Date, I'm not allowed to remove. Billable, I am allowed to remove. Cost, I am allowed. Item, I can remove. Customer, I can remove. Quantity, I can remove. But these 3, I can't. and the columns that you cannot remove will all depend on the transaction type that you choose in the top right. Now, before we actually copy and paste transactions from Excel, let's set up the journal report. And the reason I want you to set up the journal report in the way that I'm showing is because it's the best way to clearly see if transactions have been entered and if they've been entered properly. So, step one, let's open the journal report. From the main menu, we click Reports, Accountant and Taxes, Journal. Now, what's next? Well, let's select all dates. That'll help us find what we're looking for. So, all dates. I hope you're following step by step. Now, let's sort the journal by transaction number and put it in descending order. What that will do is that will bring the most recently entered transactions to the top of the journal. Sort by transaction number in descending order. So we're going to click Customize Report from the top left, and we're going to click Sort By, and we'll choose transaction number, and Sort By will sort in descending order. Now when I click OK, you can see transaction 246 was the last one, 245, 244, 243, etc. Now the journal looks the way we need it to look. So let's save it up in the icon bar so we can access it very easily. View, add journal to the icon bar. Now, even if you were not doing batch enter transactions, I recommend to all my clients that you set up the journal this way, because if you're entering many different kinds of transactions, you need to know where you left off and which ones were entered and which ones were not. By doing it this way, the most recent ones are right at the top, and you know if they were entered and how they were entered. Now, here is the Excel spreadsheet that we're going to copy and paste from. In this case, they're invoices, and these are the column names, which I'll put in red, just so that you know you should not copy and paste the column headings, only the data. And you should know that I set this up as invoices, and right now these column headings match the invoice choice in QuickBooks in the enter batch transaction window. So if we choose invoice, you can see date, number, customer, amount, item, quantity, rate, and total. Date, number, customer, amount, item, quantity, rate. And of course, I didn't bother putting total because QuickBooks will calculate that. So I matched the columns before I started this video, but you will know how to match the columns by doing what I just showed. Now, before we copy and paste all of those invoices, I just have to quickly mention what the rules are for entering batch transactions. Number one, the columns must be aligned. That's also called mapping. But I showed how you're able to do that in QuickBooks, and you could also do that by going to your Excel spreadsheet and using your Excel knowledge to change the order of the columns. The date format must be here. Two spaces for the month, two characters for the day, and four characters for the year, separated by the forward slash. So my Excel spreadsheet already has the date in the proper format. If you put the date in a different date format, or you put in a different number format, you will not be able to record the transactions and you will get an error. There are different types of date formats. If I click here, and you can see it's the date. If I choose the date to this type of format, so open it up a little, it will not work when you copy and paste from Excel. Now, the second rule is there's only one item per transaction. Unfortunately, you cannot import import an invoice or a check or a credit or any transaction that has items in the body of the transaction where there's more than one per transaction. So invoice number 661 only has five of the education service, nothing more. The next invoice has six of the web services and so on. Now you can try, just for illustration purposes, I'm gonna make these two invoice numbers the same, because some people think that if you make the document number the same, QuickBooks will put the two different items on the same invoice. It will not. They will be recorded as two separate invoices that happen to have the same invoice number. So unfortunately, if it's a check, credit, or invoice, you cannot put more than one item in a transaction. Now, all names in the field must be spelled exactly as they are spelled in the QuickBooks file. If there's even one character difference, the transaction will not be entered, and it will just stay there in the batch transaction field, in the batch transaction window, until you fix it and make it the correct spelling. So now let's copy and paste from Excel, and the example we're doing is invoices. So here we are back at the invoices, and here we are back at the enter batch transaction window for QuickBooks. And once you have the columns aligned, it's very, very simple. You simply highlight with click and drag the data part. Let's go all the way down here. Oh, by the way, I want to bring your attention to invoice number 669. Instead of putting quantity and rate, I left those blank and put amount, because when you make an invoice, you're allowed to put only an amount instead of quantity and rate. And that also holds true for copying and pasting from Excel. So we copy only the data, not the column headings. We come to QuickBooks, we click in the top left corner. Now, I suggest we remove the number suggestion and the date suggestion that QuickBooks gives us. And now that it's blank and the cursor is in the top left field, very simple. Right click, paste, and all of the information gets immediately copied here. Now notice what happened here. I purposely misspelled the name of the item, and it's highlighted in red. That means when I click Save Transactions, this will not be saved. So watch. Oh, notice there's a guy named Dave who I also didn't put on the customer list. You can fix this very easily by clicking before you click Save Transaction. But watch. Let's only fix Dave. Click here, click up here, and then click Add New. Dave, that's all you have to do. Click OK, and now the red, you know, it no longer highlights in red because Dave is on the list. But education instead of education is not on the list. Okay, now we could add an item education, but let's not. Let's click Save Transactions, click Yes, and it says 8 out of the 9 have been saved, and we click OK. Now, this one has not been saved, and it remains on the list because of the misspelling. But before we correct it, let's make sure the other ones were really entered. Let's open the journal report, and you can see 669 was entered here. Okay, 667, 666. Well, why was 668 skipped? Because 668 was not entered. 668 had the misspelling, which we'll fix instantaneously in a moment. But look, here's 666, 665, 664, and they're all invoices. And if you double click on any of them, you get exactly what you saw when you copied and pasted from Excel. So you can see anything from 669 going all the way down, anything from 669 down to, I guess, 661 were just recently entered from Excel. Now let's fix this. You can click here. If you agree with the quick add, would you like to add it now? Yes. You come to the item window and click service, but unfortunately you have to choose which income account goes with that service. So let's cancel it and let's simply spell it correctly. Okay, now that it's spelled correctly, we're allowed to save it. Okay, or we can simply remove it. You see, we can just choose the proper item spelled properly, and then it will let us record it. And now when we come back to the journal, you see 666 was recorded the most recent, because I just recorded it right now. And as you can see, it's at the very top of the journal. Now, we record credits in exactly the same place that we record invoices. And you may well ask, how does QuickBooks know it's a credit? Well, if you're using the quantity and the rate column must be negative. Now, I know that sounds strange, but I already tried on the phone with a QuickBooks Tech Support Pro Advisor person to make only the quantity column negative. And when I tried to save it, it popped it back to positive. But if you make the rate column negative, it will record it as a credit instead of an invoice. And if you're using only the amount column instead of quantity and rate, as I mentioned you were allowed to, then the amount must be negative. So when we come back here to our Excel file, these last two on the bottom, I put the amount as negative. And I put the amount as negative so that QuickBooks will know that this is, these are credits. And I didn't bother with the rate or with the quantity. But I'll do another example with rate and quantity just to show you which one has to be negative. So we highlight this, click copy, come back to QuickBooks. Now I'm going to open the Enter Batch Transactions, choose Invoice and Credits, and again go to the top left, remove the number suggestion that QuickBooks suggests, and remove the date, click Paste. Now, notice the amount stayed negative and QuickBooks filled in the rate. But don't worry, if the amount is negative, QuickBooks knows that this is a credit. Save the transaction, click Yes. Two have been saved. Now to check that they've been recorded properly, open the journal and they're right on top. 671 and 670 are both credit memos. And if I double click, you can see it's a credit memo because we put the amount as negative from the Excel spreadsheet. Now to illustrate that last point, I made two additional credits where one of them has the negative number in the rate column, that's this one, the one to Joe, and the one to Sally has the negative number in the quantity column. Now let's highlight both of them and see which one QuickBooks accepts and which one QuickBooks will not accept. Open the batch transaction window for invoices and credits. Okay, remove the number suggestion and the date suggestion. Paste. Now notice, okay, this one, the rate was negative, but it flipped it over to make the quantity negative. Don't touch it. Let it do what it needs to do. But with this one, as you remember, the 7, the quantity was negative, and QuickBooks, the crazy thing, removed the negative and just kept it this way. So you have to type in the negative yourself and then click Save Transaction, yes. And then they both went in as credits, and you can prove that by coming to the top of the journal. For Sally and Joe, they both went in as credits. So that's somewhat unusual behavior, but you'll get used to it and you'll work around it as you do batch enter transactions.